Good morning, church. Good morning, Clara's awake. Let us stand and worship together. We're so glad to be together as God's people on this beautiful day. Let us sing his praises.
We worship the God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord, our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. As he hung upon that cross and he rose up from that grave, my God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. So we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise.
Let us read this invocation together. I'll read the words in white, and you can read the words in yellow. Praise be to you, O Lord, God of our ancestor Israel, from everlasting to everlasting.
Yours, O Lord, are the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours.
Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all.
Wealth and honor come from you, and you rule over all.
In your hand are power and might to make great and give strength to all.
Now, our God, we give you thanks and praise your glorious name.
Amen. Let us continue singing.
God and King, His love endures forever. For He is good, He is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise.
A mighty hand and an outstretched arm.
His love endures forever.
And for the life that's been reborn,
His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise,
sing praise,
sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. God is with us forever. Forever.
From rising to the setting sun,
His love endures forever.
And by the grace of God we will carry on.
His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise,
sing praise,
sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever.
Our scripture this morning is from Psalm 107, and these verses remind us that God is for His people and He works against the wicked. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story. Those He redeemed from the land of the foe, those He gathered from the lands from east and west, from north and south. Some wandered in desert wastelands, finding no way to a city where they could settle. They were hungry and thirsty, and their lives ebbed away. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and He delivered them from their distress. He led them by a straight way to a city where they could settle. And then verse 33, He turned rivers into a desert, flowing springs into thirsty ground, and fruitful land into a salt waste because of the wickedness of those who live there. He turned the desert into pools of water, and parched ground into flowing springs. There He brought the hungry to live, and they founded a city where they could settle. They sowed fields and planted vineyards that yielded a fruitful harvest.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations, so why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. He won't. He won't. Still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense, so I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength, 'cause I build my life on Jesus. He's never let me down. Faithful in every season, so why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. He won't fail.
He won't fail. Good morning. I'm Kurt Piepenbrink, and I'd like to welcome you to First Covenant Church, where we are disciples who make disciples. And I have a couple announcements for you. Rough chronological order. After the service, we'll have snacks, if you can just exit over here to your left. And after the snacks, we'll have Sunday school for everyone, children and adults alike. Adults will stay upstairs, children will go downstairs. This will be at approximately 10:15. In a week, 1 week, we're actually going to pack the boxes for Operation Christmas Child. So immediately after the service, go downstairs. Everything will be made ready. And you, particularly children, but everyone can pack boxes. And that's necessary for sending these boxes to needy children abroad, but it's not sufficient. It costs about $10 to get the box from here to its final destination. So we'll be having a collection, as I understand it, next week. And then the week following on the 24th, we're actually going to have kids stationed in the back to shake you down to get that $10 per box so we can get these boxes where they need to go. Approximately a week after that, Saturday the 30th, we're going to decorate our church for Christmas, for Advent, I guess, properly speaking. I'm actually not sure when that starts on Saturday, Evan. 10 a.m. on the 30th. Be here, and you can help decorate the church. We've done a little bit of decorating ahead of that. You may have noticed we now have a Christmas tree out already, and that's a giving tree, and it's a giving tree for Hawthorne. And to tell us more about that, I've invited Ashley.
So the global and local outreach team, we are supporting early childhood home-based providers. And these are teachers who work for LPS that go out to homes, to daycares, to community sites, and do, in fact, a couple teachers usually come, and when I say teachers, it includes teachers, speech pathologists, occupational therapists, physical therapists, services coordinators, a whole wide range of teachers to support children with disabilities. There's also a couple of those providers who come here and work with kids in Kids First. I don't know if there's anyone currently, but these are teachers who don't have, and again, when I say teachers, I'm including all of those groups. They are providers who don't have a parent-teacher organization and who work year-round. They work throughout the summer. They work over Christmas break. They work over spring break, through all the breaks, and often are providers who kind of get forgotten sometimes within the whole school system. So our outreach team is really wanting to support them, especially around these times where they're having to work where maybe a lot of the other teachers have off. So we have a giving tree out in the cafe. I don't know what we call that area. Anyway, there's a bunch of ornaments on the trees with things that we will set out for these teachers, and they work out of Hawthorne, which is about 48th and O. And they're things that will be really helpful for someone who is out driving a lot in the winter. So we have things like hand sanitizers and lint rollers for when you go into a home with lots of pets. We have hand warmers, some ice melt, some emergency ice scrapers, things like snacks, some water, and little coffee cups. Just lots of things to support them, to tell them that we appreciate them and we recognize the work they're doing throughout the entire school year. Not the school year, the entire calendar year. So please grab one of those ornaments or a couple ornaments. We would like those items turned in by December 15th, and then we'll drop them off right before where most LPS employees go on Christmas break.
Thank you, Ashley. All right. I can see the ushers are chomping at the bit back there, but we're not quite ready because we have a special prayer for autumn and the changing of the season. There's always time for prayer. Our prayer today comes from Father Peter Jarrett. God of all creation, you give us the gift of seasons to mark our journey through time. The season of autumn, with its change of colors and falling leaves, reminds us that sometimes things must die and fall away for new life to arise. Such is the message of the cross, that through death to self, we find life in all its richness. In those moments when we experience setbacks or failures, help us to remember that you are with us always. There is no failure or sin your love cannot heal. Help us to trust in you and your promise of new life. Amen.
All right, while they're getting ready, we are going to invite our children to children's worship. Alicia's in the back, so if you're a kid and you're going to go to children's worship, now's your time. And while you're going back there, I'll make an announcement to the kids, and it relates to the adults, I guess, too. Last week, I made a silly comment about grabbing two cookies, to which there was great disappointment from kids when they went to the line and thought that there were other cookies that I had for them out there. So kids, I made you cookies. They're out there for after worship, and if the adults want to eat them, they can too, okay? So anyways, all right, kids, kick us off, and then you bless us, we'll bless you. And also with you. Well, good morning, everybody. I'm Pastor Evan. We are going to open up to 2 Kings chapter 1. And we have two more weeks looking at the lessons from the life of Elijah. We took a break last week. We were there 2 weeks ago in the world of Elijah. And this is sort of a continuation of where we ended 2 weeks ago. So I'll bring you up to speed. And actually, in order to do that, I'm going to go back a page in my Bible to 1 Kings, the last three verses there. in 1 Kings where it kind of brings us up to speed. It says, Ahaziah, son of Ahab, became king of Israel and Samaria in the 17th year of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, and he reigned over Israel 2 years. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord because he followed the ways of his father and mother and of Jeroboam, son of Nebat, who caused Israel to sin. He served and worshipped Baal and aroused the anger of the Lord, the God of Israel, just as his father had done. Now, having gone through much of this so far, is anyone surprised that he did evil in the eyes of the Lord just like his father and everybody else? That's been the case through all of this. They are now, at this point of King Ahaziah coming in, 86 years into the divided kingdom, Israel in the north, Judah in the south. This is related to Israel in the north. They're in the second dynasty, the Amorite dynasty, 36 years into that by the time we get to Ahaziah. So he's the great-great-grandson of King Omri. He's the son of Ahab, who we've read about, who's been sort of the nemesis of Elijah through this whole thing. King Ahab is described as the worst of all of these kings that have come along in those 86 years. And do we expect that his son's going to do any different after him? But what's interesting is, what we also saw 2 weeks ago is that King Ahab, the worst of all these kings that's come along in this 86-year saga of a divided Israel up in the north, he actually humbled himself. That's what we saw 2 weeks ago. He humbled himself. And I'll just recap that. You don't need to turn there, but back in 1 Kings 21, after hearing that he and his wife were going to die a pretty grisly death because of their disobedience, finally the judgment's going to come. It says, when Ahab heard these words, he tore his clothes, put on sackcloth, and fasted. He lay in sackcloth and went around meekly. And God saw that. And then it says, God looks at Elijah and he says, have you noticed how Ahab has humbled himself before me? Because he has humbled himself, I will not bring this disaster in his day, but I will bring it on his house in the days of his son. Now, after that message a couple weeks ago, I had a few different good conversations with people bringing up a very interesting and important point that leads us into this week's text, which is, why does Ahaziah have to pay the price for his father's sins? Right? A few different people brought that up, and we had some good conversation. And the way I first approached it as I was talking to people was with the second commandment, which I'll read for you now. It'll also be on the screen. I'll read the one that comes from Deuteronomy. It says, you shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. That's how I first approached it, and I think we can go further with it, though. That is to say, God is merciful. God is gracious. God actually doesn't want to visit on the children the sins of their parents. And the way it's actually phrased is, it's more prophetic than anything else, the way it's phrased. That the guilt of the fathers is going to affect the kids, because that's what happens when you do wrong. Right? It doesn't just affect me, and it doesn't just affect you. There's an if-then that's there about this, which is what prophecy really is. It's not just telling the truth. It's saying, if you do this, then this will happen, but you could also do this, and this better result would happen. And God is actually a God of blessing. God's a God of mercy. I think that's pretty clear. I'm going to bless. I'm going to show love to 1,000 generations of those who love me. That's what God wants to do. And in fact, that's God's inclination. And so with that in mind, what I want to do is go where I invited you in the first place, 2 Kings chapter 1. We'll read all 18 verses of it. And I want you to be on the lookout for, where do you see God's mercy in the text? After Ahab's death, Moab rebelled against Israel. Now Ahaziah had fallen through the lattice of his upper room in Samaria and injured himself. So he sent messengers saying to them, go and consult Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron, to see if I will recover from this injury. But the angel of the Lord said to Elijah the Tishbite, go up and meet the messengers of the king of Samaria and ask them, is it because there is no God in Israel that you are going off to consult Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron? Therefore, this is what the Lord says, you will not leave the bed you are lying on, you will certainly die. So Elijah went. When the messengers returned to the king, he asked them, why have you come back? A man came to meet us, they replied, and he said to us, go back to the king who sent you and tell him, this is what the Lord says. Is it because there is no God in Israel that you are sending messengers to consult Baalzebub, the god of Ekron? Therefore, you will not leave your bed you are lying on. You will certainly die. The king asked them, what kind of a man was it who came to meet you and told you this? They replied, he had a garment of hair and had a leather belt around his waist. The king said, that was Elijah the Tishbite. Then he sent to Elijah a captain with his company of 50 men. The captain went up to Elijah, who was sitting on top of the hill, and said to him, man of God, the king says, come down. Elijah answered the captain, if I'm a man of God, may fire come down from heaven and consume you and your 50 men. Then fire fell from heaven and consumed the captain and his 50 men. At this, the king sent to Elijah another captain with his 50 men. The captain said to him, man of God, this is what the king says, come down at once. If I'm a man of God, Elijah replied, may fire come down from heaven and consume you and your 50 men. Then the fire of God fell from heaven and consumed him and his 50 men. So the king sent a third captain with his 50 men. This third captain went and fell on his knees before Elijah. Man of God, he begged, please have respect for my life and the lives of these 50 men, your servants. See, fire has fallen from heaven and consumed the first two captains and all of their men, but now have respect for my life. The angel of the Lord said to Elijah, go down with him. Do not be afraid of him. So Elijah got up and went down with him to the king. He told the king, this is what the Lord says. Is it because there is no God in Israel for you to consult that you have sent messengers to consult Baalzebub, the god of Ekron? Because you have done this, you will never leave the bed you are lying on. You will certainly die. So he died according to the word of the Lord that Elijah had spoken. Because Ahaziah had no son, Joram succeeded him as king in the second year of Jehoram, son of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah. As for all the other events of Ahaziah's reign and what he did, are they not written in the book of the annals of the kings of Israel? This is the word of the Lord. First of all, before we go on at all, if you don't have people in your life who are like the third guard who can tell you the truth, find them. You need people like that who, when we're not getting it, will get it for us. You need those people. What I want to point out today, and I said, look for God's mercy in the text. He's got three warnings, along with three separate warnings, basically, that come along that showing God's power. God's mercy is there. And what I want to say is two things about God's mercy and then the issue of repentance that comes with that. So God's mercy, let's start here. God's mercy is an invitation. It's an invitation to turn from going away from God to going towards God. Repentance is the fancy word that we use for that. And that's what's happening here. It's God's mercy being extended to someone who otherwise would face the sins of his father. But his father repented, so he could too. God's mercy is an invitation to that. There's a prophetic warning to it. Turn towards me, or else things are going to get bad. But the invitation is to turn towards me. And I was struck that they should have known, all these kings that I'll mention in a moment should have known, from the Amorite dynasty, from earlier, from Jeroboam, son of Nebat, and all his children that were kings for those 86 years, the king should have known. Back in Deuteronomy chapter 4, before they went into the promised land, just listen to these words, God had given the warning through Moses, after you've had children and grandchildren and have lived in the land a long time, if you then become corrupt and make any kind of idol, doing evil in the eyes of the Lord your God and arousing his anger, I call the heavens and the earth as witnesses against you this day that you will quickly perish from the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess. You will not live there long, but will certainly be destroyed. The Lord will scatter you among the peoples, and only a few of you will survive among the nations to which the Lord will drive you. There you will worship man-made gods of wood and stone, which cannot see or hear or eat or smell. But if from there you seek the Lord your God, you will find him. If you seek him with all your heart and and with all your soul. When you were in distress and all these things have happened to you, then in later days you will return to the Lord your God and obey him. For the Lord your God is a merciful God. He will not abandon or destroy you or forget the covenant with your ancestors, which he confirmed to them by oath. Now, this is foreshadowing what could happen if they continue to disobey. Israel is going to find that out eventually. But they could turn and obey. God's mercy is an open invitation, constantly there when we've turned away, if we'll only hear and turn back. And that call back when we're far from God is a need to repent when we respond to that. And so I was thinking about that this week as what that repentance looks like, because sometimes we can say something like that to just repent. But I wanted to put some sort of flesh on it, some ideas from Scripture on it. So I thought of two different, actually I thought of a bunch of different, but I'm only going to give you two different kind of known entities who repented in the Old Testament who I think give us the language to how to respond to God's mercy. And they're both Old Testament examples, and I'll give you a couple honorable mentions at the end, too. But the first one that came up was King David. And a couple times in his life, he had to repent. He had to respond to God's mercy that came to him in similar fashion. You know, not as many times, but in similar fashion to what you see here with Ahaziah. The one that's most well known is King David and his affair with Bathsheba. And a lot of innocent people suffer the consequences of David's disobedience there. And then he's finally warned, and he turns. And we got a couple psalms that actually reflect his heart in that moment. Against you and you alone have I sinned, creating me a clean heart, Psalm 51. But the lesser known one, I think, is that when he calls for a census to count all the able-bodied fighting men. It's unclear in either text that we get it exactly what the offense is, but David clearly knew it was an offense. And he was warned it was an offense, and God took it as an offense. And what's interesting is that David then is caught in both of those occasions. He's caught with Bathsheba and that and called out, and then he's caught and called out here with the census. And his response in both cases is to turn and repent. All right, turning away from the ungodly direction, turning towards. And the language that he uses in 1 Chronicles, I thought I'd give you as an example of repentance. It says, "Then David said to God, 'I've sinned greatly by doing this. Now I beg you, take away the guilt of your servant. I've done a very foolish thing.'" So he acknowledges the problem, he asks for forgiveness, and he turns. And repentance is really that simple in essence. The other example that stuck out to me of somebody who repented, this would come in the days of exile, so a little bit later in Israel's history, is Nebuchadnezzar, actually. A fascinating moment in his life where he's had these warnings, even though he's the king of Babylon, he's had these warnings and turns to repentance and even calls after incidents with Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and he says, "Well, you know what? We need to worship that God." And then he always turns away every time. He kind of says, "No, now come and worship me again." And then finally the word of the Lord comes to him and says, "You need to turn fully, or else what's going to happen is you're going to end up out in the field eating grass like a cow for 7 years. And he has almost a year to respond to that. He doesn't know that's the time frame, but he has almost a year by which he could respond and turn and repent. And what does he not do? He doesn't turn. And what happens? The king of Babylon ends up in the field eating like a cow for 7 years. Until finally, he says this, by his own pen, it says, "At that time, I, Nebuchadnezzar, raised my eyes toward heaven, and my sanity was restored. Then I praised the Most High. I honored and glorified him who lives forever. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and exalt and glorify the King of heaven, because everything he does is right, and all his ways are just. And those who walk in pride, he is able to humble." He recognizes his folly, and he turns from the fool's path into a godly path, seeking to glorify the living God. The honorable mentions, if you wanted to look them up later, are Balaam and the talking donkey, Zacchaeus in the tree, and the prodigal son, the parable of the prodigal son. But if we look at just those two examples to understand God's mercy as an invitation and then that call to repentance, to turn away from and towards God, what we can see in those stories and what we can see actually in this 2 Kings passage is that God's mercy is not just an invitation, but it's active. It's a remarkable thing to consider that our God is a seeking God, not a hiding God. He seeks us out. He wants us to come to him. He wants us to receive his mercy, and he continually extends it towards us. So no matter how faithful or how far you've gone from God, God is constantly calling you closer and closer to him and to his presence. And so with that in mind, I want to return to the question that was asked to me a couple different times. And I want to shift the question a little bit to ask it this way. Is God merciful to the children of disobedient parents? Yes, is my answer to that. Because if you look at the list of kings of Israel, you have Jeroboam, I don't have them memorized, so I'm going to read them. Jeroboam, Nadab, Baasha, Elah, Zimri, that's the first dynasty. Then you have Omri, Tibni, Ahab, Ahaziah, and then a couple more. You've got Ahaziah's brother here who takes over and is even less useful than Ahaziah. And they face the consequences of their fathers in all those cases. Right? They're all just worse and worse and worse and worse and worse and worse and worse until King Ahab. But why can we say that they don't have to necessarily follow in that path? Because the worst king of all of them, Ahab, actually repents. Any one of them has the option to break the cycle at any time. They can repent. God's mercy is there. It's there for them. Ahaziah now has a choice to do the exact same thing. And that doesn't mean that all the consequences of everything their fathers did or their parents did is gone. But it does mean they get to chart a new course for themselves and for the next generation by God's mercy. That's what it means. But I want to drive it to a more important question. I'll get there in a second, so don't get ahead of me upstairs. Because there's a more personal question I think we can ask that relates to all of this. And I want to start with a story. There's a guy that I became friends with at the last church I was at in Colorado, who was, at the time, kind of mid-late 70s, wonderful man. English not his first language at all. In fact, he had taken English in his country of origin up until about eighth grade, and then hadn't had to use it at all. He'd used other languages because he worked in a couple different other countries in his life. And then he ended up in Colorado living with his daughter and grandkids after his wife passed away. And for most of his life, he didn't follow Jesus. And you could see when you talked to him, he regretted every moment that he didn't follow Jesus once he turned to Jesus. Just completely regret. Just that was wasted time in his mind. And I would pick him up. We had a men's Bible study that was meeting for a little while early in the morning, and I'd go pick him up early in the morning, 5:45 or something like that. And he was a very quiet man, constantly in prayer, constantly reading scripture, helping his kids and grandkids. But you could see that, one, when he turned to Christ, there was great joy in his life. And that came out of him. There was also great wisdom because he just sat and prayed and read the scriptures all the time. And he had a life of not following Jesus now that he could dwell in the life of following Jesus. And the wisdom that came out of his mouth was remarkable when he did speak. But what I saw most that he wore heaviest was that none of his kids or grandkids knew Jesus. And that was the thing that guided every ounce of his prayer life. Because he wore that so heavy. He regretted that he didn't pass on this joy. And now had limited time to do it. That was a remarkable thing and very powerful for me to see. And it made me think, as I thought of my friend, I thought of this further question of not just thinking of the sins of parents or that kind of thing that we see here, but maybe a more personal question that we can ask. What damage is done to others by my refusal to repent and receive God's mercy? If I receive God's mercy and I pass that on, what blessing is given, but what damage is given by my refusal to listen to the voice of God in turn? And so there's this important need that we have to repent for so many reasons. To repent. And if you don't know Jesus, we need to turn there because he is the way, the truth, and the life. There's no other path but him. And for those of us who actually do know Jesus, there are certain parts of our life that we sometimes still hide from him. there's still a need to turn from those places where we try and hide the reality of what's going on in ourself from both ourselves and from God. And quite often, the two things that make us hide those things that need to be redeemed are shame. We sometimes feel like we're unworthy of God's love, or we're ashamed to reveal those, or pride, right? We don't want to lose face. But God knows those things. God loves you, first of all, and God knows those things, and God's mercy is an invitation to fix those things. And as we look back at the text here and all the warnings that our friend Ahaziah received, it reminded me of the old anecdote joke. It's not even really that funny, but it's telling the one of the guy in the flood sitting on his front porch as the floodwaters come up, and a truck comes by to rescue him. And his response is, now God's going to save me. I don't need to take the truck. And then the floodwaters get to the porch. They're about to come in the house. The boat comes by. And he says, no, God's going to save me. Don't need the boat. And then he's sitting on the roof as the floodwaters have engulfed the whole house. Helicopter comes by. Nope, God's going to save me. And then he drowns. And he's standing before God. And he says, God, why didn't you save me? And God said, I sent a truck. I sent a boat. And I sent a helicopter. What else did you want me to do? Sometimes we miss what God is giving us. Sometimes we miss the message. Sometimes we try and hide those things from God. And you can see that David, for whatever reason, he didn't fully learn his lesson after Bathsheba. He still went into sin the next time with the census, but then he finally learns. You can see that Nebuchadnezzar didn't really learn from his incidents with Daniel and then his incidents with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But finally, after 7 years of eating grass, he learns. Right? The lessons come harder for some of us than others. Ahaziah was warned multiple times in ways that should have been obvious to him, right? He should have known when the fire came from heaven, that should have sparked something in him like, oh yeah, I remember my parents went through a similar situation like this with fire coming from heaven and things went really bad for them. But yet it doesn't do anything, yet he completely ignores all those warnings, and it does actually beg the question for some of us, how many warnings does it take to turn? What we need to do if we're going to repent, if we're going to make sure that all those things are concealed before the unconcealed before the living God and revealed to him so that we can turn fully, is we need to learn to be honest about our spiritual condition. And the first step in doing that and the continual step in doing it is simply to call on God's Holy Spirit to reveal that to you. There are parts of us that we try and hide from God. There are times when we try and walk away, even though we've gotten multiple warnings. We actually need to call on God to help us turn. Holy Spirit, reveal in me where I need to turn and repent. What needs to be redeemed in me? And the other thing that comes along with this is we need to be people who pass on that truth, that share God's mercy with others. And I think those two shouldn't be separated out. If you're a disciple of Jesus Christ, you hold something that other people need, truth, and God's mercy that goes along with that. Ahaziah had bad parents. And for some people, that's been their story too. It's hard. Some people have good parents, some have bad, some have mixed in between. That's the story we come along with, and God can do a lot with that. And Ahab, I don't know what he passed on to Ahaziah. I don't know all that was there. There should be, given what we see in the text, there should be things that Ahaziah should have recognized. There are some obvious things there. But Ahaziah had the opportunity to turn. And we do too. But we also have the opportunity to share that mercy once we've received it. And I thought to myself, I'm thankful. I have the blessing of having had parents who shared Jesus with me and grandparents who did the same. I've had the blessing of a church that did that with me too. Thank you. I grew up here. Thank you. I had the blessing of people who invested in me to share with me what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, and we need to continue to do the same. Parents need to do that with their kids. Regardless of what the past was, we chart a different future when we turn to Jesus. We as a church need to be people who pass that on, speaking the truth and mercy of Jesus Christ to the world. Starting here, we turn, but we also share that mercy with others. And if You hear that as an invitation this morning to God's mercy, the seeking God who's looking for us. Let me end with these words from Hebrews 4:16 as your encouragement. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, it seems a terrifying thing to most of us to call on your Spirit to reveal in us those dark places and the places where we try and do it ourselves without you, where we ignore the promises that you've given to us, where we ignore the fact that you're seeking us out, where we ignore your mercy and we try and do our own thing in this world. And for some of us, it's a longer learning process that's a failed project. But Lord, we acknowledge today that that's a failed project to do this life on our own without you. Because you've given us this life, you've gifted us with this life, you've made us in your image. And through all the brokenness that breaks and fractures your image in us and in this world, you've redeemed us through Jesus Christ and called us to be children of God. Lord, for those of us who are not yet children of God, who don't know your Son, Jesus, may your Spirit call us to turn today. For those of us who hide those parts in us that still remain fractured and broken, thinking we can do it ourselves, Lord, may your Spirit reveal to us what needs to be healed and then begin to heal us. May we be receptive, Lord, to repentance. May we be like David hearing your word and saying, I've sinned and I'm done with it. Rather than like Ahaziah saying, who do you think you are, God? I don't need so many warnings, I can do it myself. Lord, may we have that spirit of forgiveness and receiving your mercy. We pray all this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Please stand and join us as we sing one final song today.
The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Amazing grace, it's His unfailing love that You would take my place, that You would bear my cross, You would lay down Your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that You've done for me.
Let's hear again from those words from Hebrews 4 as an invitation today. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Go in peace.